Recorded Books presents Cruz by Nicolás Ferraro. Translated from the Spanish by Mallory N. Craig Kuhn. Narrated by Luis Moreno. Part 1. Brothers. Chapter 1. The last name is a hereditary disease. Dad's brown eyes and black hair weren't his only gifts to us. He passed down his demons, too. It took me a long time to realize that the most important things you inherit can't be packed away in a box or in a coffin. I had a friend whose father blew his own brains out with a sawed-off. The blood splashed halfway across the wall. It went from red to burgundy and finally black. My friend didn't know what to do about it. It took him a month to decide to clean the wall. He washed off what he could. The buckshot had buried bits of brain and bone in the pocked cement. My friend scrubbed and scrubbed. He scraped. The brick made it hard for him to know where his dad began and ended. He finally knocked the wall down and put up a new one. Even so, he still goes with his bucket and rag every week to clean it. And he scrubs and scrubs until it's his fingers that bleed on the bricks. I didn't know what to do with the stuff my old man left me either. I didn't know how to get rid of it. Most of it was packed up in boxes for almost 15 years, piled up in a room in the house that used to be his. A house I've been living in since last summer. Since the first day I moved in, I go to bed every night telling myself that I have to throw his shit out. The answer's always the same. One of these days. I take out a box filled with my family's rotting remains and set it down next to the other five that are waiting on the sidewalk. A gray dog comes over and sniffs at it. He barks, wanting something from me. Not all skeletons are made of bones. That's what I'd tell him, if he could understand. He lifts his leg, pisses on the boxes, and trots off, wagging his tail. The last rays of sunlight glow on the dust that floats in the living room and sticks to my sweaty skin. I pull my shirt up from my waist and wipe my face. I let out a long breath, looking at all the work still ahead of me. In my old man's room, a lamp with more fly shit than wattage shines on boxes stacked together like Tetris blocks. The smell hits me in the face as I enter. I shove a box away from the wall with my leg. A few bugs scatter before burrowing deeper into the pile. I stack two boxes and carry them out together. My fingers sink into the cardboard, soggy from the humidity. I manage to set them down with the rest before they come apart completely in my hands. I should have just burned everything. On the table is a glass of ice water that turned into warm broth half an hour ago. I pour it on a fern, though it's more in need of a miracle than a watering. I get myself another glass of water and stick my head under the tap before going back to the living room. It's like there's a mirror between the open doors of the two bedrooms. In mine, boxes that have been collecting dust since I arrived from Buenos Aires that I'll unpack one of these days. I always think I won't be here much longer, that someone's going to take away the for sale sign in front of the house. I drain the glass and get back to work. I take another four boxes out, but the room looks as full as ever. A few doors down, Christmas lights come on and illuminate the front of the house like a shopping mall. In the distance, two more houses blink on and splash color on a girl in a dress and a backpack passing by on her bike. The reflectors in the road shine with the headlights of the regatta pulling into the garage in front of the house to the left. A guy with a mustache gets out and waves to his neighbor on the other side who's out watering his garden. He's got all kinds of plants, red ones, yellow ones, purple ones. I should ask him if he has any ideas for my fern. Or just haul it out and leave it with all the other garbage, the cherry on top. They chat for a minute and say goodbye with a smile. The one with the mustache walks by me and waves. He doesn't even say anything about the weather. No, it's a hot one today, or we sure could do with some rain. I don't even know what his name is. I'm still surprised by how much is left in the bedroom. Next to the door, there's one solitary box. The last one of the day, I tell myself. This one's heavier than the others. A rotten smell comes out of the hole in the middle and puffs in my face with each step. The box crumbles like a sandcastle. I leave it with the others. 3 steps later, my foot lands in dog shit. I rub my eyebrows. I fill my lungs. I empty them. The phone rings. Once. Twice. Fuck whoever it is. 3 times. It might be my brother. I take off my sneakers and leave them at the door. By the time I make it to the phone, the answering machine has come on. Viviana, my sister-in-law. I pick up. Do you know where your brother is? Is her 3rd question. I don't know any more than you do. Yesterday he called and said he might swing by your place before he came home. He wanted to see you. No idea. I haven't talked to Seba in a couple days. Silence. Your niece is asking if we're going to see you before Christmas Eve. Tell him to come, Mom. I can hear Violeta's high-pitched voice in the background. Come over and we'll order some food. Why? We're just going to stare at each other, playing a chess game of silences to cover up the questions we're afraid to ask ourselves. Violeta keeps talking. Hang on, Lele, my sister-in-law says. Okay, I'm going to give the phone to this little nag. I don't have time. I'm in the middle of something I want to finish. What are you doing? Taking out the trash. Viviana snorts. Did you open up the back bedroom? She says. You're supposed to rest during Christmas vacation, hon. And Seba freed you up from the bar for a couple of days so you could go to Buenos Aires, not sit home and play archaeologist. More silence. I switch the phone to the other ear. The answering machine has 6 new messages, even though I was here when they were recorded. They all say pretty much the same thing. She called me the other day, Viviana says. She's worried. She says she calls you and you don't pick up. I told her to come for the holidays because if we leave it up to you, let me take care of my own business. A bug crawls up my arm and I flick it off. Out the window, I can see 2 kids looking at the boxes. One is dragging a cart and eyes my sneakers. Tomas, says Viviana. What? Stop dicking around and call Alina. If I hear from Seba, I'll let you know, I say, before she can launch into her sermon and I lose my sneakers. When I get outside, my shoes are still there. The kids are hovering over the boxes. A few photos slip out between the wires of the cart and fall on the red dirt. They're only going to get a few coins for that whole pile of paper. It's the first time in years my old man's memories have been worth anything. They see me. One of them taps the other on the shoulder and they stop rummaging. Take everything, I say. But they're already hurrying off. I pick up a photo without looking at it and use it to scrape the shit off my shoe, then throw it back. The wind picks it up and makes it flutter. A couple of gray clouds take bites out of the moon and a pink sky. Night comes early. I sit on one of the lawn chairs around the living room table. The blinking number 6 is my only light. It's the closest thing I'll have to Christmas lights this year, and the closest thing to company. I'll call Alina one of these days. I look for a beer. In the fridge is a container of mustard, a shriveled head of lettuce, and a rock that used to be bread. I get another glass of water and drink half of it without taking a breath. The fern hasn't perked up. I go over and give it some more water. The garbage truck comes by and picks up the boxes. I feel better. A shower washes away the sweat and bad mood, for a little while anyway. Half an hour later, I'm lying in bed, sweating like a pig again. I try to watch a movie, but my eyes keep drifting over to the back bedroom and the pile of boxes. I can't even get into Back to the Future. I start to nod off. Marty's mom wants to get a look at his package. Boxes. I blink. George McFly finds his balls and beats up the bully. More boxes. I blink. The doc meets himself. Whatever happened to that guy? Must be pretty fucked up to meet yourself. I can't see the boxes anymore. I open my eyes again. A snake is slithering over Salma Hayek's tits in a rundown whorehouse. 2:15 on the clock. The same red six blinks on the answering machine. Where's Seba? What did he want to tell me? I close my eyes. I can't get back to sleep. I turn my back to the door and face my own boxes. What am I going to do with these? I wish I had to wash a stain off the wall. The red number 6 keeps flashing at me. It might never become a 7 if I don't do something. I reach out and pick up the cordless phone. I dial the area code for Buenos Aires. The dial tone buzzes. 4957. I take a breath. The sheets stick to my skin. I hang up and exhale. I don't even know what the hell to do with a few boxes, much less with her and her questions. One of these days. One of these days is another way of saying never. I stare at a map of water stains on the ceiling. A piece of plaster is hanging from a spider web. A mosquito whines in my ear. A car parks outside. I don't recognize the sound of the motor. It's not my brother's truck, and it isn't my sister-in-law's Mondeo either. It could be a local taxi. A flash of blue light paints the ceiling and tells me it isn't. There's a knock at the door. When I open up, a gray-haired cop takes a step back to let me see the Misiones police crest on his car. His partner is leaning on the hood with his right hand on his gun. Tomás Cruz, says the cop at my door. His name tag says Barrios. Whatever that old piece of shit did, I don't care. This time, lock him up and give him life. Relax, kid, he says, giving me a smile. It's not your old man this time. Chapter 2. The cruiser heads downtown. Barrios drives and looks at me in the rearview mirror. His smile pinches a scar under his eye, making it disappear in the wrinkles. He looks older when he smiles, and like more of a piece of shit. What did he do? I ask. Carried on the family tradition, he says, and then turns to his partner, a sergeant whose name badge I didn't manage to read. You were still sucking on your mom's tit the first time I had a cruise in the back seat. These two idiots is dead. Good old Samuel, a real tough motherfucker. And smart, too. He could sell gloves to an amputee. For Samuel, there are two kinds of people. The ones whose hands he'd shake and the ones whose hands he'd cut off. He looks at me again, expecting a comment. When I don't oblige him, he goes on. That night we brought him in because he beat up a guy called Leva, who was a witness in a trial against some of Samuel's friends. We found Leva lying on the floor of the garage. His wrists were tied up with wire, his left eye was gone, and there were little bits of him everywhere. When he opened his mouth to ask us for help, I'll never forget it, kid, the three teeth he had left were just hanging from his gums. There was a beer bottle on the floor. The cap was all bitten around the edges and it was covered in little bits of skin. When we asked Samuel about it, all he said was, next time he'll buy himself a bottle opener or learn to keep his fucking mouth shut and not act like a jurupalangana. The sergeant pushed his fingers against his teeth as if someone was scratching their nails across a blackboard. I've heard worse and better stories about my old man. I stopped caring about them a long time ago. I try to think what part of the family tradition Seba might have carried on. I give up after a minute. There are too many possibilities. You should have seen that beer bottle, Barrios says. All covered in blood. I mean, I've seen my share of shrines to El Gauchito and San La Muerte, but that thing looked like a candle for praying to somebody a hell of a lot worse. Barrios stops talking and crosses himself. I don't know if El Gaucho or the Reaper always follow through, but Cruz sure as shit does. Leva knows that better than anybody. I remember wiping his face, but blood kept pouring out of that eye. You can't imagine the puddle he was lying in. We get stuck at a stoplight. It's the only light on the block. How long was he in for? The sergeant asks. 5 hours. When the green light floods into the shadows, the cruiser moves forward again. The next day, Leva came in all bandaged up like a mummy and said Cruz had acted in self-defense. He laughs. I guess his memory was as fucked up as his face was. He didn't open his mouth at the trial, and Samuel's buddies went free. As we move downtown, Posadas becomes brighter. The shirtless people sitting in the doorways of their houses are replaced by people laughing in bars. Everything on the other side of the glass seems far off and unreal. I still remember... Barrios pauses and shakes his head. Samuel didn't have any ID, but everybody knew him. They said he'd been arrested in a few different provinces. That night, I brought him the card to take his prints and said, play it again, Sam. He looked at me and laughed, and he says, don't worry about the ink, and left all 10 prints in Leva's blood. He raised his boys with those same hands. See? How do you think they'd turn out? I've asked myself the same question. I stopped trying to answer it years ago as soon as I realized it would never lead to anything good. Can you just tell me what Seba did? I say. And I know nothing good will come of that question either. He won a trip to see the place where your old man spent 13 years. He's going to have a long time to check it out. How long do you think? He asks his partner. Well, I'd say 5 to 10, easy. Enough time to know his cell by heart. Maybe he can ask old Samuel for some advice. What do you think, Tomas? I don't answer. You're right, he continues. He should have asked before. Your old man never would have gone down for something so stupid. He cut a cop's eye out and managed to stay on the outside. His friends did him favors, too. He ended up in jail. He should have ended up with 2 in the back and 1 in the head. Well, nobody said life was fair, I say. Tell that to your brother, Barrios says, stopping in front of the station. The sergeant gets out first and opens the door for me. Through here, he says. We walk by a few rooms and down hallways until we reach the officers' desks. A completely blue room. The uniforms, the walls, even the little Christmas trees have blue garlands. It's stuffy and smells like cigarettes. Barrios keeps walking, and I stay with the kid. Luján, I read on his name badge. That's the name of a famous church. I feel the need to believe in something, in anything. For a man whose faith is blind, a rosary is a page read in Braille. Luján sits down at his desk. In front of him is a computer screen with an anti-glare protector where I can just make out my brother's information. I can't read what he did. Can you tell me anything? Barrios peeks his head around a door and waves for Luján to bring me in a little room. Wanted posters, billow out on the artificial wind of a rotating fan. Some of them have been there so long, they're yellow. Barrios fills out a form and gives it to me. Visitors, I manage to read. My hand shakes as I sign it. Do you want to know what he did? He says. I nod. Look, that didn't fall out of Santa's sleigh. On top of two tables pushed together are burlap bags spilling over with bricks of marijuana. You can see him now, Barrios says, and opens the door to the holding cells. Chapter 3. The night they took my old man away, the lights on top of five police cruisers painted the world blue. I made it to the front door and saw them herding him down the sidewalk. He had a t-shirt covering his face and his hands cuffed behind his back. Two cuts in his right wrist widened as the blood seeped out. The shouts had woken me up at dawn. I thought it was my brother and his friends still celebrating that Seba had made the 4th Division of Revered Plate. The next day was going to be his debut. As I got up, the shouts became swearing, and I realized I was wrong. As I ran out into the street, my brother caught me and held me tight against him. I managed to pull my face away. The blue lights were spinning. 10 cops made a tunnel that ended at the open back door of a cruiser. The cop closest to us looked at us and laughed. The blood pooled in my father's closed palm and dripped off his fingers. Another cop walked over and pulled the t-shirt off his head. He wanted everyone to see that they'd gotten Samuel Cruz. I tried to run, to save him. I kicked, I tried to break free. Seba held me tighter. I started to cry. My tears made a dark stain on my brother's shirt. Don't take him away. You can't take him away. Tomorrow we're going to see Seba play. Daddy promised me. And this time it's going to be true. This time isn't going to be like the other times. I wanted to scream all of that at them, but all I could do was cry as they took him away. Samuel managed to break free long enough to kick the cruiser a few times before 5 of them shoved him into the back seat. One of the officers picked up his hat, which had fallen into a puddle. Next to the door were 3 dents. I remember thinking my old man was as strong as a car crash. I tried to see his face. All I found was the back of his head, which was becoming less blue as the cop cars left one by one. I looked at him, waiting for him to turn around and tell us it was all just a mistake, that tomorrow we'd go watch the game. I swore at the cop who stood there, laughing. I wanted him to raise his shotgun and shoot me. And then I'd realize the whole thing had been a bad dream. But he just kept laughing. And my dad didn't turn around. His cruiser was the last one to go. The back of my old man's head got smaller and smaller as they drove away. His neck, so thick that even the biggest hands could never have closed around it, looked broken as his head hung toward his chest. Seba hugged me tighter. He stroked my head. His hands were sweaty. A drop fell in my hair, then another, but every time I looked at him, my brother froze the tears in his eyes and said, "Everything's going to be okay, Tommy. Everything's going to be okay." He said it over and over until it was just the two of us sitting alone on the front steps. Right there, we promised each other that no matter what happened, we'd be together, that nothing and nobody would ever separate us. Nothing. Nobody. A couple of hours passed before we went back inside. On my old man's nightstand was the closest thing we would find to a goodbye letter. On top of the glass, in a frame that held a picture of the 3 of us, he'd left his final lines. 2 straight white rows of blow and a rolled-up 1,000 austral bill. My brother grabbed the frame and threw it against the wall. The coke and plaster mixed together in a cloud that settled on the picture, covering us up. 13 years was what they gave my dad. Exactly my age. And he got off easy. If even a quarter of the things they said about him were true, his rap sheet would have been enough to fill up a whole cell block. It took me a long time to find out about all that, a really long time. Back then, I was just a kid who'd lost his daddy. By the time daddy became my old man, I started to learn the truth, and my old man turned into a son of a bitch. When they put him away, I filled up 2 spiral notebooks with all the days I had to cross out before getting him back. The night I crossed out 315, we got a visit from Alvarenga, my old man's right-hand man. Whenever he came over, he had the same ritual. He unzipped the top pocket of his black leather fanny pack and gave some crumpled bills to my brother. Then he took out a Zippo and lit the hand-rolled cigarette he always had behind his ear. Once he finished it, he'd roll another one and leave. There were more than a few stories about him and that damn fanny pack. One went that no one had ever seen him without it. A hooker named Maribel even said he left it on when he fucked her. Some people said it was where he kept all the teeth he'd knocked out of people's heads. Everybody else said that was a lie because he would have needed a backpack to fit them all. Another story was that if he unzipped the top pocket, it was to solve a problem for you. But they called the lower one the dead man's pocket. Whenever he unzipped that one, someone wasn't going to see another day. That same night, my brother had shown up with his head shaved. They'd chosen him to play in the summer tournament with the first division. He was telling Alvarenga about it when I came into the kitchen. My old man's friend grabbed me and rubbed his knuckles in my hair. Then he unzipped the top pocket of his fanny pack and gave me some money. "Get yourself whatever you want, Guri," he said. I came back with half the candy aisle from the corner store to celebrate. Alvarenga was standing and patting Seba on the back. My brother was staring at a piece of paper in his hands. When Alvarenga headed for the door, he didn't even see me, almost knocked me over. I stumbled backwards. The fanny pack was level with my eyes. The bottom pocket hung open in a smile. He zipped it up and grabbed a chocolate bar from me, sticking a new cigarette behind his ear. My brother was still staring at the wrinkled piece of paper between his fingers. 3 names and addresses were scribbled on it. "What's that?" The first inheritance our old man had left us, I'd find out later. My brother folded the slip of paper and put it in his shirt pocket. "A couple of things I have to take care of. Don't worry about it." The day I crossed out 330, Seba crossed out the first name on the list. 6 days later, the second one. One night, not long after that, the phone rang. It was the soccer club. My brother hadn't shown up, and the bus needed to leave from Mar del Plata. "I don't know where he is." "Tell him if he doesn't show up, don't bother coming back." I fell asleep waiting for him, looking at his new cleats sticking out of his half-packed gym bag. The front door slamming woke me up at 3 in the morning. His bed next to mine was still empty. I heard him grunt and go into the bathroom. There were dark droplets shining on the wood of the door. As I peeked my head around, I could see him in the mirror wiping blood from a cut in his eyebrow. His lip was split. He threw something into the sink, which swung heavily from side to side. He sat down on the toilet and started to cry. Someone knocked at the front door. I saw Alvarenga's car and ran to hide. Seba went out shirtless to talk to him.
"Your old man didn't exactly leave you guys a debt,"
Alvarenga said with a short laugh.
"Not in money, anyway. And these people..."
I stopped listening. I went into the bathroom. The t-shirt on the floor was leaving a puddle that crawled along the grout between the tiles to create a cage of blood on the floor. The piece of paper was crumpled up in the trash can. In the sink was a 9mm that had left scratch marks in the ceramic. And the cage kept growing. The sound of the door slamming sent me running back into the bedroom. I caught a glimpse of Seba leaning against the wall with another slip of paper in his hands. As he cleaned himself up in the bathroom, I looked at his gym bag again. He'd hung up his brand new cleats. I opened a drawer, took out my notebooks, and threw them in the trash. My brother turned off the light. I heard him stop in the doorway to look at me. I pretended to be asleep. I didn't know what to say. There was nothing I could say. He didn't get into his bed that night. My brother went into my old man's room and made it his own. And I realized that sooner or later he was going to end up in the same place as our father did. Chapter 4. My brother is waiting in the middle of the room, handcuffed to a painted metal table. He doesn't look at me, not even when I walk over and sit down in front of him. The chair rocks on the uneven floor. With the index finger of his free hand, Seba picks at the O of a rati puto, or fuck the police, gouged into the paint on the table until he makes it a hole. Since the night he locked himself in our old man's room, my brother has been living as two people. One, the family man, the father, the husband, the brother, and the other, the businessman, who would disappear and come back with a bag of money or a scar. The part that made me remember, ignorance is bliss. "They gave me my old number back," Seba says, nodding at the number 3 above the cell's open door. In his first soccer club, way before he'd ended up in River, they used to play Seba as a fullback. He didn't like it one bit. He scored so many goals, the coach had no option but to give Seba a chance to play forward. And that's where he'd won the number 11. "If I have to be honest, I liked it better when you played defense. Any klutz can play forward. To be a defender, you need personality. You were someone else on the field. You wouldn't let anyone pass you, especially because you knew one-armed Almada was the goalie." His hair is stuck to his muddy face. His t-shirt, which used to be white, is the color of a rushing river. My brother looks like something that floated to the surface after a flash flood.
"Almada, I had forgotten about that son of a bitch. He was playing for Colegiales a while back. He sucks even more now that he's older. But at least he's still playing."
He lowers his head, hits the table twice. Chips of varnish fall off.
"I fucked up, Tommy," he says. "I fucked up."
That's how the two parts start to come together and let me see what's on the other side.
"I was good at soccer. The day I hung up my cleats was one of the worst days of my life. I see guys who used to play with me in the pro leagues now, here or over in Europe, kicking ass, making a fortune, doing what they love. And it kills me not knowing where I would have ended up, never finding out how good I was."
He tugs at his left hand. The cuffs stop his hand with a jerk and cut into his wrist. He moves his right hand over and scratches his arm. The dried mud looks like scales on his skin and a few chunks flake off onto the table.
"And this," he says, pointing at the cuffs. "I didn't choose this. I just happened to be good at this too. And sooner or later, if you're good at something, you end up liking it, needing it. When everything went to shit in Buenos Aires, I felt worse than the day I stopped playing soccer. Even though I'd already done what I had to, I felt like shit because I was already too old to go back to soccer. But in this business, maybe I could make a comeback there." I didn't want to keep wondering what the hell happened. And it was the right call.
That's one way to put it. We'd gotten some money out of selling the house in Buenos Aires. My brother used it to open the bar he owned and I worked in. It was great. We made money hand over fist, even though there were never more than 10 people in there drinking. There was more movement on the deposit slips than at the tables, but the register was always full. That's where my 2 years studying accounting and Alvarenga's tricks for laundering money came in handy. My brother's life was looking up. He switched out his rusty Taurus for a Ford Ranger and his studio apartment for a three-bedroom house with a front yard. Violeta was enrolled at a private school.
You know what, Tommy? I learned two things today, he says. One, that I'm no good at this. And two, that Rio de la Plata isn't the widest river in the world. The widest river in the world is the one you have to cross in a boat loaded with 50 kilos of weed.
He closes his eyes. He takes a deep breath and exhales through his nose.
It was so fast. They came out of nowhere.
He shakes his head, opens his eyes. He looks me in the eye for a moment. I don't say anything. There's nothing to say. I can hear the sound of a fan overhead. Laughter, too, I think. Maybe. When I listen closely, I can't hear it. Seba scratches at his arm a little more.
The DA is sending me straight to jail. He says I'm a flight risk or that I could intimidate witnesses. Bullshit. The truth is they're putting me away for possession of a last name.
His smile cracks the muddy wrinkles around his mouth.
But don't worry. My lawyer said out of the 50 keys, they only logged 20. And by the time they finish divvying it up in here, they'll be locking me up for a few joints. I'll get 3 years, tops.
3 years? My brother stretches. With his free hand, he grabs my forearm and says again,
don't worry. Everything's going to be fine. If that old fuck could take 13 years, three's nothing.
His fingers pinch my skin. He looks me dead in the eyes.
I have to ask you a favor.
His face crumples in a grimace and he shows me the palm of his cuffed hand.
I need you to take care of them for me, he says.
Of course. I put my hand on top of his. He lowers his eyes. He takes a deep breath, but it's not in relief. It's more like he's psyching himself up for something.
What is it, Seba? Tell me. I didn't want to do this job. It didn't sound right, but I'd fucked up before, Tommy. They didn't give me much choice. They said that whatever happened, they'd give me 2 ounces. I just had to choose of what. 2 ounces of cash for me, or 2 ounces of lead for my wife and daughter.
His voice falters. He pulls his lips in between his teeth. The wrinkles on his forehead come together in a web, and dried mud falls on the table. He pulls at his left hand, forgetting about the cuffs. He takes his right hand off my arm and tries to cover his face, but one hand isn't enough. Seba, tell me.
I need someone to finish the job. I need you to take care of my family. Can I count on you?
Seba's fingers dig into my arm again. The dirt melts and becomes slippery with our sweat.
Tommy, can I trust you?
I think about all the promises that must have been made across this table. To stay together or move on. And all the shit in between, a whole lot of shit, because the hardest promises to keep are the ones you make to desperate people. When people are desperate, they ask you to do the impossible.
Of course, brother. Of course.
He lets me go, and I can see his marks of his fingers printed in mud on my arm. I want to, but I can't bring myself to tell him everything's going to be okay. I hear banging overhead. The metal door clangs against the wall, and Barrios comes down the stairs. My brother leans in as close as he can and whispers to me,
Alvarenga will call you tomorrow.
He gives me half a hug. That's what's left of him. Half a hug and a promise that sounds an awful lot like a debt. As I climb the stairs, I think about the door to my old man's room opening up again. When I get home, there's a blinking red number 7 waiting for me. I sit down in a lawn chair. Each blink separates my body from the darkness. I stand up and hit play. Hi, Tom. It's Alina. I wanted to let you know. Message erased. Next message erased. And on through all 7 until there's nothing left but shadows and one truth. The past is the one thing that nobody can take away from you, no matter what you owe them. Chapter 5.
The first time I saw your brother, says my sister-in-law, he was sitting at a bar, picking the label off a bottle of beer. He just sat there like that for half an hour, didn't even take a drink.
Cigarette smoke comes out of Viviana's silhouette against the window. The amber light filters in through the slats of the shade, and the rotating fan cools the sweat on my back, then rustles the dry leaves of the fern. The only thing deader than that plant is the phone. A song by NSYNC is playing in my room. My niece sings along. She printed out the lyrics she found online on the blank side of my Anatomy 1 notes, a memento of the 2 years I'd tried to become a doctor before thinking maybe accounting was more my thing. My niece is making better use of those notes than I ever did. Her voice is indifferent. Viviana stubs out her half-smoked cigarette and starts playing with the lighter, spinning it between her fingers. We're sitting in the lawn chairs, staring at the wall as if we were looking at the ocean. There are just a few nails here and there.
My mom worked as a waitress for 5 years, Viviana goes on. She said that people who ordered something and didn't drink it had either just fucked up big time or were getting ready to. All I saw was a guy who needed a smile. When he looked over at me for the 3rd time, I gave him one, and he gave me one back.
Her face is lit by a red glare, then disappears behind the smoke of a new cigarette.
Since Seba didn't get up, I made the first move. I sat down next to him and asked him if he was waiting for someone. He nodded, but before I could leave, he stopped me. He asked if I knew anything about horse racing. I said I had no idea, and he says, the guy I'm waiting for doesn't know anything about it either, but he likes to bet a lot. And he nods towards this guy sitting at a table reading a newspaper. Another guy gets up and walks over to give him a little piece of paper and an envelope, and he puts it in his pocket really quick. So now I'm in a tough spot, he says. The only thing this Bayerque guy likes more than gambling is painting.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.